All right. Thank you all for coming once again for this weekly Bible study centered on the Dead Sea Scroll faith. We finished last week the three-part teaching, so this week's going to be something completely different. We have people ask questions whenever they want throughout this, and I'll answer whatever people ask about any topic, even if it's not related to the main teaching that I'm doing. And so that's what we're going to do today. I'm going to pick a main teaching, but I'm also going to answer some questions that people have on the side too. Before I pick the main teaching, I'm just going to see. Laura spoke of, she was interested in possibly me teaching about the end times, Antichrist, the rapture. Is that still something you'd like me to do the teaching this time, Laura, or would you like me to do that on another week's teaching? Because if you want, I can try to answer some of that. In weeks past, I've discussed that before, but there's so much depth into it. I think this time I won't. Okay, you said any time, so I think this week I won't deal with the end times information, and we'll discuss that another week. Do you guys want me to go through one of the books showing the differences in manuscripts, or would you like me to go through with you, read some of the passages of one of the extra books, and then I share my ideas or my thoughts on the passages that I read? So which of those two? Do any of those two appeal to you? If they don't, then we'll just try to do whatever appeals to you guys. Laura says she would like me to read through one of the extra books. Do I understand you correctly? And what about you others? Is that what you would like me to do this time? Or would you like me to kind of show some of the differences in variants of one of the books? So Barbara also seems to say she'd like me to read through one of these extra books. So I think perhaps that's what I'm going to do. Yeah. So this week's teaching, I think what we'll do is, let me see here. I have a good idea of which book we'll focus on. It's probably the one of the Rhonda's asking, one of these extra books it could be Enoch, Jubilees, one of those books that I'm going to be focusing on and going to be reading to you guys and then sharing my thoughts on. I'm not going to be reading the whole thing. I don't want to do it like that. What I want to do is just read passages that I find important. The whole thing is important, but just kind of giving you an overview, reading through some important passages. Or perhaps giving you a study. I'm gonna do the testaments. I was considering the possibility of one of the fragmentary scrolls, the Dead Sea Scrolls. But I don't know if I'm gonna do that this time. But instead, I'm gonna do the testaments of the 12 patriarchs. This will be the focus of this week's teaching. The reason I picked the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs is because, in my opinion, that's one of the most important books that I believe is scripture. I trust it a lot. It has so many agreements with the Book of Jubilees. They're clearly connected. Jubilees authenticity is very much linked to the authenticity of the Testaments. It kind of goes one with the other in many ways, because there's so many correspondences. And as I might show today, or perhaps in another teaching, the Testament of Amram was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and it was never known before the Dead Sea Scrolls were found. However, portions of the Book of Jubilees strikingly correspond with the Testament of Amram, which shows that it's clear that the Book of Jubilees was being derived from the Testament of Amram. It was actually incorporating that and using it as a source. So the basic idea is, you know, if Jubilees is scripture, then all the different books that Jubilees endorses are also scripture. Because you'll go through the Book of Jubilees, and it'll tell you that Enoch wrote a book. And it describes, in summary, the book that Enoch wrote. And it says in Jubilees that Noah wrote a book, and that Abram wrote a book, and Jacob wrote a book. So all these books that were written, it's clear that Jubilees was dependent on other written documents. And that if Jubilees is scripture or authentic, then these books that it was based on have to also be authentic. And one of the books that it was based on is the Testament of Amram, which was found in the scrolls. And we know this because just the correspondences. It's just, they're too similar to be coincidence. And it has to be the case that there's no indications that the Testament of Amram was based on the Book of Jubilees. And since we already have said that Jubilees claims to be based on many other writings, it's logical to conclude that it was also based on the Testament of Amram. So, the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, as I said, connected intimately with Book of Jubilees. Before I go into this, I have to let you know that the scribes did something a little unfortunate with the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. Basically, like as I have explained to you how the Book of Deuteronomy and other books of the Bible in the Old Testament have been radically altered and shortened, many passages removed, the same thing has happened with the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. Basically, someone went through the whole book and they condensed it into a shorter account, a summarized version. How do we know this happened? When the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, copies of the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs were found. There was also copies of it found outside of the Dead Sea Scrolls, perhaps from the Dead Sea Scroll discovery that happened 1,000 years ago. Because as I've said in other teachings, there were other Dead Sea Scrolls found about 1,000 years ago. And those Dead Sea Scrolls most likely included the Testaments of the Patriarchs, just as the modern find of the scrolls also had copies of it that were found, but just very small fragments. And when you compare those fragments that were found of the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs with the Greek translation that comes much later in the manuscripts, we see that the Greek is significantly shorter, much shorter than the Aramaic and Hebrew fragments that have been found. There is a Testament of Naphtali which exists in Hebrew, and it's preserved by the rabbis. So as we know, the rabbis sometimes alter some of the things that they have received. So there's certain things about the text which we have to be careful of, but in the main, the Hebrew Testament of Naphtali gives us a picture of the original version of the Testament of Naphtali. When you compare it to the Greek version of the Testament of Naphtali, that Hebrew version is significantly larger. So basically, there's only two testaments of the 12 testaments which have been found outside of the Greek, the main Greek version, the shorter version, that is. And they were found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and the rabbis have preserved some of it. So the Testament of Levi and the Testament of Naphtali. All the other testaments have not been preserved. Some of the scholars suggest the possibility that the Testament of Judah might have been found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but in a tiny fragment. But it's so little is preserved, it's kind of questionable at best, that identification. But so it is my position that the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs are scripture. The Greek version is a very accurate, trustworthy, and reliable shortened version of the original. So just like I believe the Book of Deuteronomy is scripture, And yet I also say that the Temple Scroll is the original version and is much superior, and we're missing so much, and it's been abbreviated so much in Deuteronomy. In the same way, I suggest the same thing happened with the Testaments, that I accept the Greek version as scripture, but it has been significantly shortened and condensed from the original. So we have to understand that this is not the original text. So there might be some errors or corruptions in it, but in general, it's trustworthy and reliable. The correspondences it has with Book of Jubilees proves that it's a trustworthy document. And so I'm going to go through that, read some of the Testament passages, because they're very inspiring. And I, as I said, I trust them, so I think that they are truly prophetic. So there are 12 Testaments, and in the current copies, they sometimes differ, but the main order that has been used in the translations is the order of the sons' births. So Reuben is first, Simeon second, and it goes on through the line of the 12 sons. The 12 sons of Jacob. Remember, Jacob had 12 sons. And so his 12 sons, they wrote words talking about their life and saying, basically, we have other examples of people in our time when they're on their deathbed or when, as they're getting approaching their old age, they gather their family around and they talk to them and say, it's almost time that I'm gone from this world. There are some final things I want to tell you guys. I want to tell you guys about my life, things I've learned, and I want you guys to learn from me. Hopefully you will learn from my bad examples or from the good examples of my life. And I'm warning you to prepare for future difficult times, because I know there's certain things that are going to happen. That's kind of the way the writings, the style of the writings. And all 12 sons of Jacob wrote an account of their lives. Hold on, one of my friends is saying something. I just have to tell her that I have to talk with her later. She's having an issue, but I can't answer her right now. The reason I took the time to tell her that is because she's going through a difficult emotional issue, so I didn't want to make it seem like I was ignoring her. I just told her I can't address it right now. So I shall read now through the Testaments. There's so much of the Testaments that I cannot cover at all, so that's why I'm only going to be reading the most interesting portions. Now, if you guys have questions about anything I read, or if you want to have comments or thoughts, please share. It will be really cool to see your guys' impressions about what I read. So the first one is the Testament of Reuben. And the Testament of Reuben is a really good one that focuses on primarily the issue of fornication and lust issues. So a lot of, you know, our world seems to have a huge problem with lust and fornication. And all throughout the Testaments, we see teachings about this. And so this is very relevant to our lives because so many people struggle with sexual sin. And so these Testaments are powerful teaching for that. Let's see. It's interesting you say that. Do you have a reference number, Het, of where you're seeing that? I don't remember the specific passage you're referring to, but I'm not doubting what you're saying is true. I just don't, I'm not familiar with it offhand. So if you remember where it was, then that would be cool to see. What I do know, like basically Het said that he seems to describe a watcher that looked like a serpent. And what I do know is that some extra writings concur with that kind of idea of these spirits, these demons, having a serpent-like image, or the serpents are kind of allies with demons, things like that. So he gave the reference number. I'm going to check that later. But before I check that, I'm going to just go through some of these teachings of the Testaments. Every Testament starts out by saying this is the copy of the Testament, and in this year of his life. He was this years old when he gave this Testament. Verse 2, for example, says, 2 years after the death of Joseph, his brother, when Reuben fell ill, his sons and his sons' sons were gathered together to visit him. And he said to them, my children, behold, I am dying, and go the way of my fathers. So you see, he is, he realizes he's approaching his death, and he's gathering his family to teach them. And this is what you see in all the Testaments. You see them realizing they're coming near their death, the end of their days, and they gather their family together. In this case, Reuben also sees his brothers, Gad and Asher, and Judah, and he talks to them, and now he greets his family, and he says, for example, he says, behold, I call to witness against you this day, the God of heaven, that ye walk not in the ignorance of youth and fornication, wherein I was poured out, and defiled the bed of my father Jacob. And I tell you that he smote me with a sore plague in my loins for 7 months, and had not my father Jacob prayed for me to the Lord would have destroyed me. For I was 30 years old when I wrought the evil thing before the Lord, and for 7 months I was sick unto death. Stop right there for a second. Basically what Reuben is talking about is, according to Genesis and First Chronicles, I think it is, it's very vague and ambiguous. It's alluded to. Basically, Jacob slept with Reuben slept with one of Jacob's concubines. Her name was Bilhah. This is explicitly stated in the Book of Jubilees and in the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs. We are told that while Bilhah was sleeping, that Reuben came in and raped her. And so this is Reuben is sharing about his experience with that, and how basically he said defiled the bed of his father Jacob. And because of this, as we know, sexual sin usually, very often, it causes illness, STDs. It can cause major health problems, especially if there's incest going on. And his father had slept with this woman, so it's unhealthy for a man to sleep with a woman that his own father has slept with. So it's unhealthy, and it's also just wrong in general. It's immoral and abomination to sleep with a woman that your father has also slept with. But so he was punished with a sickness for 7 months in his loins. And just like with the issue of Moses, you know how Moses, God wanted to destroy the Israelites for their sexual sin and their wickedness, but Moses intervened and he prayed for them and said, please do not destroy them. The same thing happened in this case. Jacob prayed for Reuben, because we are told, Reuben in his own words said, had not my father Jacob prayed for me to the Lord would have destroyed me. Now, I trust what Reuben says here, and I assume that he's correct, and that Reuben knew that Jacob was the only thing that kept him from being alive. Basically, how I interpret this is, this sickness that he had was probably going to kill him. He was close to death. He was majorly sick. But his father Jacob prayed for his healing, and he was healed. Now, why was he healed? Not just because Jacob prayed. That was the primary aspect of it, because had not Jacob prayed for him, he would have been destroyed. But Reuben also repented, as I will read in a second. But so remember, he said, I was 30 years old when I wrought the evil thing, And for 7 months I was sick unto death. So that supports what I just said. He was close to dying, but he was prayed over by Jacob, and his sickness was healed. And it continues saying, and after this, I repented with set purpose. So after 7 months of being sick unto death, he says, and after this, I repented with set purpose of my soul for 7 years before the Lord. And wine and strong drink I drank not, and flesh entered not into my mouth. And I ate no pleasant food, but I mourned over my sin, for it was great, such as had not been in Israel. That phrase, the sin was great, such as not been in Israel, that also appears in the Bible as well. In Genesis, it uses that same language. I thought I turned that off. That's my alarm again. Sorry. So, this is an example of fasting. It's an example of fasting as a part of your repentance. Because if he's fasting and mourning for his sin, and yet he's drinking, being merry, and eating all kinds of delicious, I love this food, you know. It's not really true sorrow. This fasting that he did was to put him in the proper mindset of what true repentance is all about. And I see David's on with us, and basically I'm going through the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, reading certain passages, and then giving my commentary throughout the entire thing. As I'm sharing my ideas, you can ask questions, or you can share insights that you have from something I said or from something I read. Or your reaction, like if you really find it amazing, feel free to say, wow, that's amazing, you know, whatever you want, as I go through. And if you have questions on other issues, feel free to ask the questions, and I'll take a break and answer those questions. But so now, then Reuben goes through, and he tells us that there are seven spirits of deceit. When he repented, he realized that there were seven spirits of deception. And he says, seven spirits, therefore, are appointed against man, and they are the leaders in the works of youth. And he also says, seven other spirits are given to him at his creation, that through them should be done every work of man. This passage is very important to me. I'm going to share why in a second. It's very special to me in my heart. It says, so seven other spirits are given to him at his creation, that through them should be done every work of man. The first is the spirit of life with which the constitution is created. The second is the sense of sight with which ariseth desire. The third is the sense of hearing with which cometh teaching. The fourth is the sense of smell with which tastes are given to draw air and breath. The fifth is the power of speech with which cometh knowledge. The sixth is the sense of taste, with which cometh the eating of meats and drinks, and by it strength is produced, for in food is the foundation of strength. The seventh is the power of procreation and sexual intercourse, with which through love of pleasure sins enter in. Wherefore it is the last in order of creation, and the first in that of youth, because it is filled with ignorance, and leadeth the youth as a blind man to a pit, and as a beast to a precipice. I'll stop there for a second. Just kind of interesting how, you know, as the scriptures say, the last shall be first, and the first shall be last. But right here he says, this seventh spirit, the power of procreation and sexual intercourse, is the last in order of creation. But it's the first in that of youth, because it is filled with ignorance. So it just kind of corresponds with the first shall be last shall be first thing. And then he says, besides all these, there is an eighth spirit of sleep, with which is brought about the trance of nature and the image of death. With these spirits are mingled the spirits of error. Earlier, he referred to those spirits as the spirits of deceit or deception. And he goes through, and these spirits, he says, are, first, the spirit of fornication is seated in the nature and in the senses. The second, the spirit of insatiableness in the belly. The third, the spirit of fighting in the liver and gall. The fourth is the spirit of obsequiousness and chicanery, that through officious attention one may be fair in seeming. The fifth is the spirit of pride, that one may be boastful and arrogant. The sixth is the spirit of lying, in perdition and in jealousy, to practice deceits and concealments from kindred and friends. The seventh is the spirit of injustice, with which are thefts and acts of rapacity, that a man may fulfill the desire of his heart. For injustice worketh together with the other spirits by the taking of gifts. And with all these, the spirit of sleep is joined, which is of error and fantasy. And so perisheth every young man, darkening his mind from the truth, and not understanding the law of God, nor obeying the admonitions of his fathers, as befell me also in mine youth. So I'll stop there a second. So the reason this passage is so special to me and important is because I was going through a really hard time almost 5 years ago, actually. At the end of 2010 and at the beginning of 2011, my ex-wife had just broken up with me. I was deeply wounded. And then not only that, I was going through a major depression because I was going through an existential crisis. It was a really painful time in my life. And so for about 4 months, I was in major torture at the first job that I had and the only job I've had in my life. I would go to that job every day and I would feel so miserable. And I felt like the scriptures were not giving me answers. They weren't helping me figure out what I was looking for. And so I was in great distress and I felt like I had no hope. During this time, there were a couple passages of scripture which I clung to with fierceness, and it helped me kind of have a bearing, and I basically used these passages of scripture as a springboard for doing some philosophy and logic, because the Bible was not answering my questions, so I had to use philosophy and logic to figure out the answers to my questions. My reasoning was, okay, well, I still trust the scriptures, so I'm going to try to find certain passages of scripture which I can use as a springboard, like sort of like instead of aiming wildly, like aimlessly, not knowing where I'm trying to aim for, I'll use certain passages as an aim, help to aim at the target. And this was one of the passages in Testament of Reuben. There's seven spirits of the constitution of man and the seven spirits of sin. What constitutes sin? So it's basically seven divisions of morality. So it helped me understand and realize that there's seven different categories of sins, and Reuben gives those categories. And then there's also these seven categories of what makes a man. And I remember from when I did the study, basically the seven spirits, or the seven divisions, is self-awareness. That's the main one. That's the foundational one. That makes a mind. And then there's the two ones dealing with knowledge, the two ones dealing with emotion, and the two ones dealing with power or the will. So of Reuben's seven spirits, I saw that one of them was self-awareness or life itself, the mind itself. The two of them that Reuben lists in what I read from earlier of the constitution of man, two of them had to do with the power or the will, strength. Two of them had to do with emotion or love. You remember the one was sexual intercourse and procreation. That's about love. And one of the other ones had to do with love and emotion as well. And then the other two had to do with knowledge. One of them was, what was it? It was, the fifth is the power of speech, with which cometh knowledge. So I saw there, the second one was desire. Now, desire was linked to the emotion. You're longing for something, loving something, desiring it. And it said the third is the spirit of hearing, with which cometh teaching. So teaching and knowledge. It's connected to the... So basically what I found was through each of the spirits that he was saying, there's one of them, emotion. The constitution of man is the parts of the man which enable you to, the mechanisms which allow you to receive knowledge, to receive emotion, and to receive power. And then the other one is the actual experience or the actual activity, the doing of those things themselves. So there's the mechanism of how you can have knowledge, and then there's the actual now you have knowledge. It's the same thing with the mechanism for emotion and the actual having of the emotions. So that's kind of how I reasoned through the what makes a man, what makes a mind. I was doing that through the philosophy and logic thing about 5 years ago, and I was using this passage as a key source of directing my thoughts on the issue. So it's a very important passage of just helping us have an overall understanding of what man is, his spirit, and what his temptations are. The seven temptations that we go through during our youth. These are major things which in our youth we are most vulnerable to, so we have to be strong and resist these things, and it's a difficult task. And in some of the spirits that I read through, the language in this translation is really confusing. I don't even remember some of what these words mean. Like, this was one of them. It was the fourth spirit. It says, the fourth is the spirit of obsequiousness and chicanery, that through officious attention, one may be fair and seeming. That's gibberish to me. I don't remember what those words mean. I've looked them up before. As long as you look up those words, you'll know what it's talking about. But it's older English that uses words which are not as common in the regular people. Anyway, so you'll have to study that passage yourselves. It's a really powerful passage about the spirits. Now, Reuben says, he says, pay no heed to the face of a woman, nor associate with another man's wife, nor meddle with affairs of womankind. So you know how the Messiah said, do not lust after a woman. It's kind of, you know, don't focus on a woman's face. Don't long for a woman's face. Because even like looking at a woman's face and admiring her beauty can be a stumbling block and lead you into sexual sin. So pay no heed to the face of a woman, nor associate with another man's wife. So don't spend a lot of time with another man's wife, alone time, things like that. And don't meddle with affairs of womankind. There's a lot of things that women do, and they're, you know, various activities, women's events, you know, there's certain events which are devoted to women. Don't go to those events. Don't spend time around women things, because it will lead you very likely into sexual sin, or at the very least, impurity in your heart, or just an appearance of evil. Hold on one sec while I let the cat out. Okay. So he continues saying, so he said, pay no heed to the face of a woman, nor associate with another man's wife, nor meddle with affairs of womankind. And then he says, for had I not seen Bilhah, so he saw Bilhah's face, but he also saw her body too. For had I not seen Bilhah bathing in a covered place, I had not fallen into this great iniquity. So basically, he paid attention to the face of Bilhah. He was associating with her, and he was meddling in her affairs, the affairs of womankind. You know, a woman bathing herself, that's something that belongs to women, and we should not be participating in that. We should not be viewing that. We should not be going anywhere near it. A separation of gender, you know, privacy. So if you don't value or respect privacy, then you're very likely going to be led into sexual sin. And that's Reuben speaking from his own experience. These aren't just his speculations, but he knows from his own experience what happened. And I know from my own experience, too, of, you know, different sins that I've done, but, you know, I've never fornicated with a woman before, but, you know, I've had similar sins myself, so I can testify to Reuben's truthfulness here. Now, so he says, for my mind, taking in the thought of the woman's nakedness, suffered me not to sleep until I had wrought the abominable thing. I've experienced something like this, too. There's a sin that you want to do. It's in your mind all the time, and you can't get it out, and you keep focusing on it. The problem is you're thinking about it. If you stop thinking about it, then you won't do it. But if you keep dwelling on it and thinking of, oh, I just want to do this, I really want to do this, you don't let it out of your mind. It keeps building and building and building until it becomes an eruption that you just can't control. You feel like you have to do it, otherwise you're going to die. That's what Reuben was experiencing. And I'm sure you guys have had your own experiences of that. For whatever sins you've dealt with in the past, you probably know what I'm talking about. Of that type of giving into a temptation of, you knew you weren't supposed to do that, but you really wanted it, and you couldn't get it out of your mind because you chose to keep dwelling on it when you shouldn't have. So that's what Reuben was experiencing. And so he said, "For while Jacob our father had gone to Isaac his father, when we were in Eder, near to Ephrath in Bethlehem, Bilhah became drunk and was asleep, uncovered in her chamber." Now, when scripture says drunk, it often does not mean drunk in the negative sense how some people, they drink so much, they can't control their actions. They are, and they're very likely to do really foolish things. Scripture sometimes speaks of people becoming drunk when they're not really drunk. They're more like they're a little tipsy, or they, you know, it's affecting them, but not significant enough where it is going to be a major problem. So I don't believe Bilhah was like, you know, super super drunk. She just had drunk a lot of alcohol, so that basically alcohol is a depressant. So even if you drink a little bit of alcohol, it's going to make you feel sleepy and knock you out, kind of. The more alcohol you drink, the more that effect and power will have over you of making you less susceptible to like being less aware of things. So she had drunk enough of alcohol so that she was not aware of when he was sleeping with her. So she was sleeping the whole time, and he was sinning with her. So he said, "Bilhah became drunk and was asleep, uncovered in her chamber. Having therefore gone in and beheld her nakedness, I wrought the impiety without her perceiving it, and leaving her sleeping, I departed." This same account occurs in the Book of Jubilees, in slightly different details, but overall it's the same story that's told. So he left her sleeping, departed. And then he says, "Forthwith an angel of God revealed to my father concerning my impiety, and he came and mourned over me and touched her no more." So basically an angel told Jacob what happened, and Jacob knew that he was not allowed to sleep with Bilhah anymore, which is pretty messed up, because here's what the scripture teaches, the Book of Jubilees and the Torah, the Law of Moses. It actually states this. That if a man sleeps with a woman that his father or his son has slept with, that's an abomination. So let me show you how this could be a horrible thing. Imagine you're a man, you marry the woman of your dreams, you love her so much, you have a child with her, and when that child, that son, is 13 years old, he then rapes his own mother. Guess what? According to the Torah, his father cannot have sexual relations with his mother anymore. The father cannot sleep with his wife anymore. Why? Because his own son slept with the same woman. And according to the Torah, it is forbidden to sleep with the same woman that your own ancestor or descendant have slept with. So this is something that if it were to ever happen to one of us, it would be a major, like, especially if you really love the woman, it would really crush your heart that you can't be with her anymore. And the same thing with the wife. She would really be crushed if she can't be with her husband anymore. So this is what happened right here. Bilhah was raped, and yet she didn't do anything wrong, but now she could not be with Jacob ever again. So we are told, "Jacob mourned over Reuben, and touched her no more." According to the law. That's what Jubilees tells us, that the law forbade him from ever being with her again. And the Torah testifies to this too. So something very difficult to accept, but that's the way that the law teaches. So Reuben continues saying, Pay no heed, therefore, my children, to the beauty of woman, nor set your mind on their affairs, but walk in singleness of heart in the fear of the Lord, and expend labor on good works, and on study, and on your flocks, until the Lord give you a wife, whom he will, that ye suffer not as I did. So basically, don't try looking for a woman, because that's lusting after a woman. You're lusting after, you want a woman so bad, you're trying to find her. I've done that in the past, you know. Don't go looking out for a woman. If you just trust in God, the woman will come into your life. I've heard of so many examples where people keep looking and looking for their future wife and don't find them, and then they stop looking, and then shortly after they find a woman. So is that a coincidence? Maybe, but it's probably not, because it happens so many times with so many people. Another thing is that some people, I'm reading from the Testament of Reuben right now in chapter 4. And so basically, with a lot of people, when someone is so desperate, they are like really trying to get to have a wife, other people subconsciously can perceive your desperation and they're put off by that. So it's very likely that that's a good reason why a lot of people are not successful in finding a mate when they're so focused on looking for one. And then when they stop looking for one, then they suddenly find one. Because the person suddenly becomes more attractive, more confident, and people are more drawn to that. And I'm telling you this right now as saying this is what the scripture teaches. I struggle with this because I like trying to seek for a mate. So I'm not telling you this as me saying I'm perfect and doing this. I'm saying this is what we should be doing, and I'll try to do this in the future, but it's really difficult. I understand the struggle. So if you be patient and don't go looking for her, but focus on righteousness, so good works, focus on good works, focus on studying, like studying the scriptures, studying science, and just learning, making yourself a better person, learning things, and focusing on your flocks, your animals, because in ancient times we're supposed to be having animals, taking care of animals. If you do that, then you will be given a wife, and you won't suffer for sexual sin as Reuben suffered. Yeah. And you have to be careful of when a woman comes into your life. It could be a test too, or you know, the woman could be the one for you, but then she could betray you and do a major sin. So there's always things that you have to discern, be open to the leading. And just because a woman wants to be with you doesn't mean you should be with her. Or same thing with a man. A man wants to be with you doesn't mean that you should be with that man. For a woman, you know, a woman should not just go with anyone, the first person who says they want to be with you. Let's see. And yeah, if someone's brought to your attention, then you don't just say, well, you know, he's gonna arrange it so that we're married. Well, if you don't make that first step of beginning or initiating a relationship, then you'll never end up with that woman. So you do have to do something, but you shouldn't be like so focused and actively seeking it yourself. It should just be something that happens naturally. And then Reuben says, for until my father's death, I had not boldness to look in his face or to speak to any of my brethren because of the reproach. So he was horribly ashamed. He goes on and says, even until now, my conscience causeth me anguish on account of my impiety. So basically, Reuben was horribly guilty, feeling horrible his entire life. That's a pretty sad thing. But that's what happens when you do a horrible sin like rape. You deserve to suffer your whole life through that anguish, that mental anguish, what you did, the horrible sin that you did. But Jacob, he was forgiving, following God's example. And so Reuben says, yet my father comforted me much and prayed for me unto the Lord, that the anger of the Lord might pass from me, even as the Lord showed. And thenceforth until now, I have been on my guard and sinned not. So Reuben says, ever since that time, I've been really righteous. I haven't sinned anymore. And Jacob prayed that the anger of God would pass, and it did pass. It happened. So he says, "My children, I say unto you, observe all things whatsoever I command you, and you shall not sin. For a pit unto the soul is the sin of fornication, separating it from God, and bringing it near to idols, because it deceiveth the mind and understanding, and leadeth down young men into Hades or Sheol before their time. For many hath fornication destroyed, because though a man be old or noble, or rich or poor, he bringeth reproach upon himself with the sons of men, and derision with Belial." So remember, the book of Proverbs says some similar things, gives examples of a man going after adulterers and then losing all his goods. He becomes poor because of it. That's what Reuben's telling us. And so if you follow his advice of protecting yourself from the spirits of sin, then you won't sin. And I can testify that once you start doing sexual sin, it becomes a pit, and you're trapped in it. And this is what Reuben's saying. A pit unto the soul is the sin of fornication. It separates you from God, brings you near to idols, deceives your mind and understanding, and leads down young men into destruction before their time. Let's see. David says, marrying a woman that has recently come to keep living according to God's instructions, yet her husband still lives. Well, the Messiah is pretty clear on that. He says, a man who divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery. And also the woman who was divorced, if she marries another, the man who marries her also commits adultery. So we have this clear teaching here of divorce does not allow for remarriage. The only thing that allows for remarriage is the impossibility of reconciliation. So when people die, you can't reconcile anymore. So you're free to remarry. Similarly, if your spouse marries someone else contrary to Messiah's word, so if they sin, commit adultery to you, by remarrying someone, well, the law tells us in Deuteronomy 24 or 25, I can't remember which, but in one of those, it tells us if that happens, you cannot return to the former spouse. The wife who marries another man after being divorced and then she gets divorced or the next husband dies, she can't return to the first husband. It's an abomination, it says. So when that happens, if a man or a woman marries someone contrary to the law, you can't return to the former spouse, so now you're free to remarry, in my understanding. But so long as the husband still lives and he hasn't remarried, you can't, that wife cannot be married, in my understanding. The Shepherd of Hermas teaches this in the fourth commandment of the Shepherd of Hermas. And as I said, the Gospels clearly teach this, Matthew chapter 19, and in the other Gospels too, in Mark and Luke. Hopefully that answers the question. And he appeals to Reuben, appeals to Joseph. He says, "Hear ye regarding Joseph, how he guarded himself from a woman, and purged his thoughts from all fornication, and found favor in the sight of God and men. For the Egyptian woman did many things unto him, and summoned magicians, and offered him love potions, but the purpose of his soul emitted no evil desire. Therefore the God of your fathers delivered him from every evil hidden death. For if fornication overcomes not your mind, neither can Belial overcome you." He appealed to Joseph as, because remember, Joseph was, the woman wanted to, the wife of Potiphar wanted to sleep with Joseph, and Joseph never thought of it. He never gave in, he never even contemplated it. He immediately dismissed it and said, "No, get away from me, woman. I don't want to be with you. That's not righteous. Stop it." So he never tolerated those ideas, and he was spared. He overcame. Joseph is an absolute role model for chastity for men. We should follow Joseph's example. We should teach our own children to follow Joseph's example of purity. And Reuben refers to some things that the Egyptian woman did to him that's not mentioned in Genesis. He said she summoned magicians, offered him love potions, but Joseph's soul did not admit any evil desire for that. So let's see here. Then Reuben continues, and sorry about the dog noise in the background. My apologies. It's difficult when, you know, you're living with a whole family and they have all other stuff. Let's see here. Reuben says, "For evil are women, my children." Does he mean all women? No, he's saying women in general are evil, just as men in general are evil too. But, so women, evil are women, my children. Since they have no power or strength over man, they use wiles by outward attractions that they may draw him to themselves. We see women do this. We see they use special charms to attract people. It says, "Whom they cannot bewitch by outward attractions, him they overcome by craft. For moreover, concerning them, the angel of the Lord told me and taught me that women are overcome by the spirit of fornication more than men. And in their hearts they plot against men, and by means of their adornment they deceive first their minds, and by the glance of the eye instill the poison, and then through the accomplished act they take them captive." I'll stop right there for a second. Many people who will hear that, they'll take a lot of offense to that and say that's sexist, that's, feminists will be all, like, infuriated by that statement right there. But we can testify that this is true in our experience, and here's how. I've heard from many different individuals, well, not many, but I've heard from several different individuals independently, which basically they said they were shocked when in college how it was females who were more promiscuous, more sexually focused than the men were. So people from their own experiences have testified this is true, and then Reuben is telling us that he received this teaching from the Spirit, from God himself. So if Reuben was lying, then Reuben's a false prophet. So we got to trust Reuben, I believe. And another reason we can know that Reuben's telling the truth about this is just look in our culture and you see how women in general, they're being raised in a culture that encourages them to make themselves attractive and beautiful, and they sexualize themselves so that men can like them. They try to have sexy clothes and try to, you know, high heels. What are high heels all about? It's to make the woman look more attractive because it pushes them up. It emphasizes their bodily features. And makeup, well, you know, what does that do? They use the makeup so they look more beautiful and more desirable. All these different things, women are so focused on making men like them and be really attracted to them. Men are not so much doing that. And when you see, like, on TV ads or on commercials and things like that, the vast majority of the time, you're going to see, the vast majority of the time, you're going to see that the males, more often than not, they're much more clothed in when they are presenting themselves. The women are almost always not clothed much at all. They're very exposed. So there's a huge disconnect. So the women we see here a clear confirmation of what Reuben is telling us, that women are more overcome by the spirit of fornication than men are. And it's women who are, primarily it's women who are prostitutes. Very few are men prostitutes. Now, of course, men are seeing the prostitutes, but the point is, they wouldn't be seeing the prostitutes if they weren't, the women were not prostituting themselves. So, basically, there's just so much focus of these women. Now, this does not, I just want to clarify, because I know there are women who have gone through horrible experiences, and I'm not saying that women who have been forced into prostitution, you know, are as guilty as women who voluntarily join in. So I wanted to make that clear. because there are some people who are sold into sexual slavery. And you can't hold them as evil as someone who voluntarily does that. Let's see. Yeah, and the Watchers taught the woman to do makeup. That's according to the Book of Enoch. And right, not all women are like this. But in general, women and men are evil. And so Reuben is warning us about avoid the Gentiles, the Gentile woman, the pagan woman, avoid them because they are impure and they will lead you astray. It says, Reuben says, for a woman cannot force a man openly, but by a harlot's bearing she beguiles him. Because a woman, most of the time, cannot rape a man. There are some cases where a woman has raped a man, but the vast majority of the time, that doesn't happen. Women are generally weaker in body, just because of the hormones. It's not their fault. Just they have a disadvantage naturally. And in general, their body design is not well equipped for forcing a man to be with her. Whereas a man is more equipped with the ability to force a woman into something she doesn't want to do. So Reuben tells us a woman cannot force a man openly, but she uses different ways to seduce the man. And again, as Laura said, this is not referring to all women. Not all women are like this. But Reuben's just drawing a generality of what he has observed in his life. And Bilhah, the woman he raped, Bilhah was not doing that. You know, so he's not trying to blame the woman for everything. He's saying you have to do your part and the woman have to do their part. But because so many women are not going to be doing their part, you gotta stay away from them. Because if you keep going near these type of women, those evil women who are seducers, then you will likely give in and sin. So avoid them. He says, flee therefore fornication, my children, and command your wives and your daughters that they adorn not their heads and faces to deceive the mind, because every woman who useth these wiles hath been reserved for eternal punishment. He goes on. This is a very interesting thing, he says. He says, for thus they allured the watchers who were before the flood. For as these continually beheld them, they lusted after them, and they conceived the act in their mind. For they changed themselves into the shape of men, and appeared to them when they were with their husbands. And the woman, lusting in their minds after their forms, gave birth to giants. For the watchers appeared to them as reaching even unto heaven. So I'll explain for a minute there. Basically, what Reuben is telling us is he had access to books that we don't have access to, by the way. So, excuse me. Or we have access to those books, but only in fragments. So he had access to a fuller scripture library than we do, of the pre-flood library, that is. He could read from Enoch's writings and Noah's writings. And in those writings, he read that the woman, they were the ones who instigated this, who initiated the sexual sin that the watchers did with the woman. It was not the watchers who offered themselves to the woman and said, let us sleep with you. It was actually the woman who, when they saw these watchers, they were like, wow, these guys are amazing. Like, look at them. Basically, they were angels. So when they morphed themselves into very beautiful forms. Would they morph themselves into an ugly image? Probably not. But, you know, there are probably instances where they might have done that. But in general, angels, you know, are like us. They want to be, they like art, they are creative, and they like to present themselves as beautiful beings. And so they made themselves as beautiful beings and very attractive. And when the woman saw them, it's just like what we see in Genesis. When the men saw the woman, the men saw the angels. Sorry, I'm misspeaking here. The men of Sodom saw the angels that came with Lot, and they wanted to have relations with those angels because those angels were really attractive. And it's the same thing in this case. The watchers came down, the woman saw them, and they were strongly attracted to the angels because the angels had morphed into a human form, but a very glorious and beautiful form. So the woman approached the watchers and asked the watchers if they could be together. And the watchers were tempted, and they were led astray by this temptation, because the same thing with what Reuben's telling us. Don't let your mind take in what they're saying. Don't hang around with them. Don't gaze at their face. Don't pay attention to their matters, because if you are spending too much time with them, you will very likely be seduced by them. Or you yourself might fall in, you might want to be with them. They might not seduce you, but you might seduce them. It can go both ways. But so he warns us about the strong power of seduction that women can have a hold over men. And so the watchers suffered this fate. And so as Reuben tells us, it was not the watchers who initiated it, but it was the woman who initiated it, and the watchers fell into sin. Rhonda says she has to go. Okay, yeah, the rest is going to be on recording. Thank you, Rhonda, for listening and spending time. I appreciate you coming. Shalom. Let's see. Okay, so Skype's gone. Now we focus on you guys. Yeah, Laura says, you know, she doesn't wear makeup, high heels, the sexy clothes, you know. So yeah, again, as I said many times, not all women are like this. He's talking about Gentile women, pagan women, who are major sinners, and not all women are like this. So we remember that he's not saying that women are all like this. He's just giving a generality. We have to remember that. Were there male angels and female angels? There's not male or female angels. They don't have a gender. But there are male and female demons. The reason for the demons, because remember, they were conceived through an angel parent who made himself male, and a human or animal parent which was female. And so the female creature with the transformed male angel produced a hybrid of either gender, sometimes male, sometimes female. So the angels were not of any gender, but when they wanted to be with those women, they made themselves, or excuse me, when they came down, they appeared as men. And so they made themselves men. So that's my understanding of the gender of the angels. Because gender only makes sense for reproduction. And according to the Book of Enoch, there is no reproduction of angels. Enoch chapter 15 tells us this. So we know for a fact that there's no marriage in heaven. There's no marriage of the angels. There's no marriage. There's no sexual reproduction. No reproducing of the kind. So there's no purpose for gender. The only purpose for gender is that reproduction. Let's see here. And he says, Reuben says, command the woman likewise not to associate with men, that they also may be pure in mind. For constant meetings, even though the ungodly deed be not wrought, are to them an irremediable disease. I didn't say that right, but whatever. And to us, a destruction of Belial and an eternal reproach. So basically, if men and women are spending a lot of time together, and they're not married, you know, they're just single, spend a lot of time together, or if they are married, but not to you, and you're spending a lot of time with them, constant meetings, even if you're not doing sexual sin with them, it causes impure thoughts into your mind. This is what Reuben tells us. So don't meet with the opposite gender like this. Laura asks, basically they transformed the watchers. They transformed their bodies into male bodies. They did not possess male bodies to reproduce. They actually took their angel bodies, because the angels actually have bodies. They're not spirits like some people say. Angels have immortal, glorious bodies, but they're angel bodies. But the angel bodies are specially powerful so that they can morph into any physical form they want to. And so these angels, they morphed their form into the form of a human. And as a human, they formed it so that it would be completely capable of reproduction, because they wanted to be an actual human. So they formed themselves to be an actual human, and then they reproduced using their morphed angelic human body, and they had children by those women. Not with other people's bodies, but with their own morphed, mutated body. Angelic, human, mutated body. So then, Reuben gives us a prophecy. Well, first of all, he tells us, in fornication there is neither understanding nor godliness, and all jealousy dwelleth in the lust thereof. In the next verse, he tells us, therefore then I say unto you, you will be jealous against the sons of Levi, and will seek to be exalted over them, but ye shall not be able. For God will avenge them, and ye shall die by an evil death. So this is some interesting information. He's telling us Reuben's own tribe is going to try to go against Levi, because they're jealous against Levi. Levi has the priesthood, the glory. So they are going to try to take it for themselves, but they are going to be defeated by Levi, and they are going to die an evil death. Reuben explains why this is. He says, for to Levi God gave the sovereignty, and to Judah with him, and to me also, and to Dan and Joseph, that we should be for rulers. I'll explain for a second why he mentions those names. Judah, why Judah? Because he was king, remember? Levi was priest. To me also, Reuben. Why to Reuben? Because Reuben was the firstborn, so he was chosen for sovereignty, Reuben. Dan, why Dan? Dan's name means judge, so he was chosen as a ruler or a judge. And then Joseph, we know he was chosen as a judge because, well, first of all, he was the firstborn of Rachel. And then he also was ruler over Egypt. And he was, remember in the dream that Joseph had, he was head over all his brothers, and all the stars bowed down to Joseph. And so it shows that Joseph was made a leader too. So that's why Reuben says those names, that Levi, Judah, Reuben, Dan, and Joseph were all made rulers. But so he's saying, yes, we were made. Basically, the Reubenites, the tribe of Reuben, were going to be envious, or jealous, actually, of Levi, because Levi had sovereignty. Levi's telling them, look, I know you guys have sovereignty, but that doesn't mean that you have the right to take their sovereignty, because they were given sovereignty for something else. Levi was given his sovereignty, Reuben was given his sovereignty. We are not to mix those sovereignties, and you need to respect his sovereignty. And I tell you ahead of time, you're not going to, and it's going to cause some major death amongst my tribe. So he's warning his own children ahead of time of something really bad is going to happen. Let's see here. He says, therefore, I command you to hearken to Levi, because he shall know the law of the Lord, and shall give ordinances for judgment, and shall sacrifice for all Israel, until the consummation of the times, as the anointed high priest of whom the Lord spake. I adjure you, by the God of heaven, to do truth, each one unto his neighbor, and to entertain love each for his brother. And draw ye near to Levi in humbleness of heart, that ye may receive a blessing from his mouth. For he, who, Levi he's talking about, he shall bless Israel and Judah, because him, that is Levi, or excuse me, Judah, he's talking about now, because him, Judah, hath the Lord chosen to be king over all the nation, and bow down before his seed, for on our behalf it will die in wars, visible and invisible, and will be among you an eternal king. So basically, here's an amazing prophecy of the Messiah. He just told us, he said, draw near to Levi, because he's going to be the one who teaches the law, and he's going to be the high priest. And then also, Levi's going to bless Israel and Judah. And why is Judah going to be blessed? Because Judah's going to be a king over all the nation. And then one of Judah's seed, the son of Judah, we are to, the children of Reuben, Reuben says, they must bow down to Judah's seed. Because on our behalf, on the behalf of Reuben's children, and on Reuben himself, the seed of Judah is clearly talking about the Messiah. This, on our behalf, that seed, it will die in wars, visible and invisible, and will be among you an eternal king. Well, the Messiah is our eternal king, and he died for us in a visible war. The Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Romans plotted to kill him. That was a visible war, and then the invisible war. The satanic forces behind the scenes orchestrated the Messiah's death in this manner. So there was a war going on in the spiritual realm as well as in the physical realm. And so this is a clear prophecy that Reuben gives us of the Messiah dying for us on our behalf, and that he is our eternal king, and that he'll come from Judah's tribe. And then it says Reuben died, and then it says Reuben was placed by his sons in a coffin until they carried him up from Egypt. And then they buried him in Hebron in the cave where his father was. So that's the testament of Reuben. Yeah, and now Philo, Het is mentioning Philo about his comments of the seen view of woman. Yeah, he says, I think if I remember correctly, he says something very similar where the Essenes kind of viewed woman as dangerous to them and as stumbling blocks that they should avoid. And also, many of the Essenes did not marry women because they thought it would be better to be celibate than to be with women. And this is kind of like, because most women were evil, they believed. And again, this is not saying that all women are evil, but they were saying in general, the majority of men are evil, majority of women are evil. And so, if you are going to be with a woman, and she's an evil woman, then she will lead you most likely into major sin. And so, they wanted to avoid that major temptation. Imagine you have a very beautiful wife, and then she comes to you and starts telling you to do all these horrible things. And then she says, if you don't do this, then I won't sleep with you anymore, or I won't love you anymore, I'll leave you, I'll divorce you. Suddenly it's going to be very hard. It's going to be a temptation of what she's telling you she wants you to do. So there's a difficulty of, do you love the woman more than God? And you have to be prepared for the temptations. And you don't want to enter marriage lightly, because it can be a very, it can be a bad thing that you regret entering into. So many people were not ready for marriage, and that's why there's such a huge high divorce rate. Because the marriage was not blessed by God. It was something they rushed into and were not seeking righteousness for. They were seeking the desires of their own flesh. And so the Essenes knew better. They knew that so many marriages were failures. And they didn't want to take that chance. They preferred to be holy and to protect themselves from their hearts and souls and bodies being wounded by women. But not all the Essenes did that. This was just a precaution that many of them took for themselves to protect themselves. And so, that's my understanding of what they said about the Essenes. Because, you know, Josephus mentions how not all the Essenes were celibates. Some of the Essenes married. So we must remember that. Sorry about the noise in the background. That's my mom. With the dog. So, that's going through the Testament of Reuben. Now, I'm not going to have time to go through all the Testaments. I did not realize it would take this long to go through just the Testament of Reuben. But you know, it goes on tangents and or it takes longer to go through the material. So this will probably have to be a multiple teaching thing, multiple weeks of study. But so I'll try to get 3 testaments at least, maybe 4 testaments in this teaching. And then perhaps in the next teaching I can do eight, the rest of them. I don't know if I'll be able to, but that's what I'll aim for. So the Testament of Simeon, it starts off with Simeon. Hold on 1 second. Sorry about that. So we've done this for about 1 hour and 15 minutes. I usually try to go over about 2 hours. If you guys have to leave sooner, feel free. And this is going to be recorded, so don't worry if you will miss some of it. So the Testament of Simeon, it says, in the 120th year of his life, at which Joseph, his brother, died, this is the testament that he spoke to his children, when Simeon was sick, his sons came to him, and so he starts talking to them. He says, I was born of Jacob as my father's second son, and my mother Leah called me Simeon, because the Lord had heard her prayer. That's what Genesis tells us, that you know, each of the sons' names were named after something that happened during their birth. And the Hebrew name corresponds with a Hebrew word that has a special meaning of a verb, usually, or a noun of describing the character of what came about when the child was born, or how the child was born, or how the mother reacted after the child was born. So basically Leah called him Simeon because the Lord had heard her prayer for a child, or to make her husband love her and that she would be blessed with children. So that's why he was called Simeon. Now Simeon goes on to say that he was very successful. He was a strong man. He says, my heart was hard, and my liver was immovable, and my bowel without compassion. I'll stop here for a second. Reuben speaks of some of the like anger, stuff like that. He mentioned it was like in one of your organs. And here Simeon is saying the same thing. Basically, the scriptures teach us that some of the like anger, stuff like that, is in some of the other organs. It's not just of your brain, but there's other organs of your body which contribute. Like it says, the gall, and the bowel, the liver. These are all a feature of what uses or helps someone have those emotions. And this is actually proven by science, I believe. A lot of scientists would disagree with this, but we've had recent discoveries in modern times of people having organ donations. They donate an organ to someone, and then the new recipient of that organ starts having changes in their emotions, changes in their demeanor, their personality, and then when they note down the differences, they find out those differences are the same features that the guy that gave them the organ had, or the girl. You know, it's an amazing thing. There's a brain in the gut too. There's like a nervous system there, you know, so it like our body is very much connected, and it's not just the brain, but it's the other parts of the body. Now, what happens when you take, you know, the brain has 2 hemispheres. What happens when you take the one hemisphere out? The other hemisphere tries to compensate but obviously, guess what? We were created for a reason for 2. So if you take one away, we're missing something. It's just kind of like if you have 2 eyes. If you take one of the eyes away, the other eye your brain tries to compensate for it, and the one eye creates your one vision, so it compensated, but you miss out because now you don't have two eyes, so your vision is not as broad. Same thing with the brain. Basically, if you lose one hemisphere, you still have the functions of your brain, but it's not as wide now. Now it's more limited. And so the same thing. If you donate some of your organs, as long as those aren't, you know, the organs that you need to live, like if you have two lungs, I think this is true. If you take one of your lungs, and as long as you have another lung, you'll be okay. But maybe that's not true. I don't know for certain, because I'm not a science expert. But usually, if you have two of them, it's, you know, you can afford to go without one. Like if you have two hands, you take one of your hands away, you still be able to do a lot of stuff, amazing stuff, but not as much. You'll have a smaller window of ability with only one hand. Same thing with your legs too. So if you lose your liver, that doesn't mean you're no longer gonna have like hardness of heart or anger. It just, the liver, according to this Simeon is telling us in the other passages of scripture, is a important part of that emotion. If you take it away, the brain will compensate for what was missing, but it'll be a smaller and less complete picture of that emotion that you otherwise would have had. So I continue. He says, because valor also hath been given from the Most High to men in soul and body. He says, for in the time of my youth, I was jealous in many things of Joseph, because my father loved him beyond all. As we know from Genesis, this is true. Joseph was the most beloved, because he was from Rachel and not from Leah. Unfortunately. That was kind of messed up on his part, but he couldn't help how he felt. Well, he probably could have helped it, but he was so focused on Rachel that he just had to love Joseph, because that was from Rachel. And Joseph looked like Rachel in many ways, so he just loved Joseph so much. But the others, he loved them much less, for that reason. So Simeon, the other brothers were not as offended, but Simeon was, you know, really, pissed off, offended, and he was jealous. He says, that's not fair. I didn't do anything, like, Joseph didn't do anything to deserve being more loved by his father. He, just like us, only he's the son of Rachel. Well, you know, that's really offensive to them. And there's 12 sons, and each of those sons reacted to this differently. They weren't all, like, horribly angry by it, but a few of them were really pissed off by how Joseph was treated. Yeah, and David asks about organ transplants, and I don't believe they are of God. I don't believe we have the right to give someone else our organs. Just like I don't believe in cremation either. I believe we should be buried because the body is sacred, and we shouldn't be giving our body parts to other people because it's not ours to give. We were never given permission. No one was given permission to give our body parts to someone else. That's something we invented all on our own. And if God ever told us that we could do it, then we could do it. But if he didn't tell us, sorry, we just can't do it, because that's how it works. God gives us permission first before we can do something. We shouldn't dare to do something and then ask questions later. He never said we can go out to outer space and go to other planets. He said, you're on the earth. You take care of the earth. That's your mission. You weren't sent to this earth so you could go to Mars or the moon and take care of those places. Your purpose is to take care of the earth. So, we were created for a specific purpose. And, hold on. Okay. The camera froze for a second. So we were created for that specific purpose, and I forget what I was going to say connected to that. But basically, yeah. So for outer space, you know, we shouldn't go there. It's not our place to do that. And the same thing with the organs. You know, we were never given that permission to give people our body parts. So there was some other thing I was going to say that was kind of neat along those same lines, but I don't remember. So my apologies for forgetting. Now let's see. And so Simeon continues and says, "And I set my mind against him," who? Joseph, he's saying. "I set my mind against him to destroy him, because the prince of deceit," who's that? That's Satan. "Prince of deceit sent forth the spirit of jealousy and blinded my mind, so that I regarded him not as a brother, nor did I spare even Jacob, my father." I'll stop there for a second. Het asks if we should send a Torah scroll to outer space. perhaps we could send satellites out to outer space if they were remote controlled. Maybe that would be okay. Possibly, I could say. I don't know about a Torah scroll though, because that seems kind of silly. The blood transfusions also, I don't think we should be doing those either. You know, we shouldn't be consuming the blood of other people. I know it's not consuming in the same sense of blood transfusion, but in a way it is, because it's getting absorbed into your bloodstream, and that's often what the... When you eat foods, it gets absorbed into your bloodstream, if I remember correctly. Again, I'm not a science expert, so perhaps that's incorrect, but that's my understanding. So, Het, if you try to share something, it says it's blocked, so I don't know if that's a website you were trying to share. If you were trying to share something, perhaps there's another way you could share it, like with spaces or something. If it's a site. So Simeon tells us that he was so blinded by his jealousy that he didn't even regard his own brother Joseph as his own brother. He treated him like a stranger, like an enemy. He wasn't even family. I'll have to check that website. That looks interesting. TorahOnTheMoon.com is what Het shared. And let's see. So, and then he says, remember I read, he says, he did not even spare Jacob, his own father. So basically, not only was Simeon pissed off at his brother, but he also was pissed off at Jacob, his own father. He was like, you know, because Jacob was giving favor to Joseph, and this made him angry. And it's not Joseph's fault that Jacob was favoring him. So Simeon understood that he couldn't just be like mad only at Joseph. He had to be mad at his father too, because that would be more consistent. Hold on, let me see. It looks like someone on... I'm just looking at notifications on Facebook just to make sure someone was trying to come. No, no one was. Well, you know, maybe people were trying to come, but they don't know how to come or something. Oh, we've got Lauren here. Not sure if that's the name or not, but thank you for coming. We're going through the Testaments of the 12 Patriarchs, which I believe is scripture, which was found partially in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And I'm reading some passages and then giving my commentary, my thoughts on it. And you guys can react or ask questions in the comment box below. So right now I'm going through Simeon's testament. Simeon, the son of Jacob, he was giving his last words to his children near the time of his death and giving them words of instruction and teaching and also some prophecies. And so he says, but his God, referring to Joseph, his God and the God of his fathers sent forth his angel and delivered him out of my hands. So delivered Joseph out of the hands of Simeon. For when I went to Shechem to bring ointment for the flocks, and Reuben to Dothan, where our necessaries and all our stores, where were our necessaries and all our stores, Judah, my brother, sold him to the Ishmaelites. Remember, that's what Genesis tells us. So Judah sold Joseph to the Ishmaelites to save him from being killed. And when Reuben heard these things, he was grieved. Reuben didn't want him to be sold or killed. He wanted to save him and bring him back to Jacob and keep him safe. So, for he wished to restore him to his father. But on hearing this, I was exceedingly wroth against Judah, in that he let him go away alive. And for 5 months, I continued wrathful against him. So Simeon says, you know, he tells us he was pissed off. He was really angry that Judah sold him into slavery, Joseph into slavery. Because in Simeon's mind, that wasn't enough. He wanted him dead. He wanted him killed. The very thought that Joseph was still alive, like, filled him with uncontrollable anger. And so he was really angry at Judah. He didn't want to kill Judah, but he was really angry at Judah for doing that. And for 5 months, he says he was full of anger. However, Simeon tells us, but the Lord restrained me and withheld me the power of my hands, for my right hand was half withered for 7 days. So basically, Simeon's going along, and all of a sudden his right hand withers, like, as a parallel, you know, paralyzed person, it, like, withers, and he, you know, he's like, he sees what happened, and he realizes, this is my punishment and judgment. This is a sign that I have greatly erred, and I need to stop my hate and repent. And perhaps if I do that, then I'll be healed. So he says, and I knew, my children, that because of Joseph this had befallen me, and I repented and wept, and I besought the Lord God that my hand might be restored, and that I might hold aloof from all pollution and envy, and from all folly. For I knew that I had devised an evil thing before the Lord and Jacob my father, on account of Joseph my brother, in that I envied him. So basically, Simeon had a true heartfelt repentance, realizing how horribly sinful he had been. You know, he justified it beforehand. He didn't think he was in the wrong. He thought he was justified because his brother had all this amazing stuff, and he didn't. It wasn't fair, and so he just justified it, just like many of us justify our sins. He justified the idea of wanting to kill him. But when he realized he saw the punishment of God, he knew, okay, I'm in the wrong here. And then once he realized he was wrong, he's like, I can't believe it. I almost murdered my own brother. How could I do this? You know, he was realizing how bad he had sinned because of envy and jealousy. And so he repented and said, I'm sorry, God, please forgive me and heal my hand. I can't bear this. This is painful. And, you know, because, you know, if you lose your hand, that's a major blow to your ability to function as a human in our world. And so he was afraid, and he was genuinely changed by this experience. It truly traumatized him, and he realized he had to repent. And so he truly repented. It wasn't just a fake thing for show, but he changed his life around. And so after the 7 days, his hand was healed. So he, just like how Reuben was warning us about fornication and lust, sexual sin issues, Reuben was telling us about that because he had his issue with Bilhah. Now Simeon is telling us, warning us about envy. So he tells us, envy ruleth over the whole mind of a man, and suffereth him not neither to eat, nor to drink, nor to do any good thing. But it ever suggesteth to destroy him that he envieth. And so long as he that is envied flourisheth, he that envieth fadeth away. So basically, if you are so envious and jealous of someone else's things to a point where you can't be happy if someone else has things that you don't, it's going to destroy you. Because as long as that person has stuff, you will feel miserable and want, like you want to die. This is the envy feeling that Simeon went through. And a lot of people go through this today. That's why there's a lot of murders that happen, because people steal from them, or they have a lot of things that, like, they view it as unfair. They think that they're entitled to things that other people have. And so it's a very poisonous thing. And so Simeon says, 2 years, therefore, I afflicted my soul with fasting and the fear of the Lord, and I learnt that deliverance from envy cometh by the fear of God. So basically, just like Reuben, he fasted in repentance for his sin. And then secondly, he learned that you have to fear God in order for you to be delivered from envy. If you don't fear God, if you're not afraid of him, then you're not going to flee from envy. You're not going to run away from it as a bad thing. And that's what happened to Simeon. Simeon's hand got withered out of nowhere. He didn't even do anything. It just all of a sudden, as a miracle, his hand just withered on the spot. No cause, no rhyme or reason, his hand just withered. And he knew that had to be God. So he was afraid of God, because he knew this was God's wrath. So he was afraid, and because he was afraid, he repented and fled from envy. So Simeon speaks from his own experience by telling us that fear of God is what delivers you from envy. You have to fear him, otherwise, if you're not afraid of him, then you won't change your behavior. A lot of people think that fear of God doesn't really mean fear, it just means you are respecting him and in awe of him. But I believe it truly means fear. You have to be afraid of him. You have to be afraid knowing he could kill me at any time. He could punish me forever if I don't meet up to his expectations. So because if he's so powerful and so much superior to me, I gotta start following him, because if I don't, then that's it for me. Because he has total control over me. So it's that fear. Not like you fear him as like a, you know, someone fears a homicidal maniac or, you know, a mass murderer. Not that type of fear. But fearing of a righteous judge, because you know that righteous judge has the power to kill you if he wants to. So you're afraid of him, not afraid of him as an evil person or evil being, but you're afraid of God as a very powerful and authoritative person, authoritative being. And so he says, Simeon says, "For if a man flee to the Lord, the evil spirit runneth away from him, and his mind is lightened. And henceforward he sympathizeth with him whom he envied, and agreeth with those who love him, and so ceaseth from his envy." Basically, Simeon's telling us, flee to God, and if you do that, then the evil spirit of envy will flee from you, because the evil spirit does not want to be around the things of God or the things of righteousness. If the evil spirit flees from you, your mind will no longer be burdened by that horrible sinfulness that's plaguing you. It'll be lightened. It'll be freed from the burden. So your mind will be lightened, and from then on, you're no longer going to be envying the person, but you're going to be sympathizing towards that person. Now, what does that mean? It means, you know, you're going to take into consideration his point of view. And you're going to think, oh yeah, well, Joseph, you know, he didn't do anything wrong. I shouldn't be angry with him. You know, it's fine. You know, and if Jacob wants to love his Joseph more, then that's his right to do. You know, you look at it from other people's perspective of, you know, now that I look at it from that perspective, okay, you know, I understand, you know, if that's how you want to do it. But Simeon wasn't doing that. He was only focused on his own selfishness and what he wanted. But when you use empathy and sympathy for other people, looking at it from their shoes, you don't envy them as much. You will be more loving towards them. So that's what Simeon realized, that if you do that, then you will have a heart of love rather than hate. So Simeon experienced that firsthand, a major change of his character. Now, Simeon then says, "My father asked concerning me, because he saw that I was sad. And I said unto him, I am pained in my liver." Remember, I said earlier that the liver was associated with the emotions. So he's pained in his liver. He says, "For I mourned more than they all, because I was guilty of the selling of Joseph." Basically, Simeon considered himself the most responsible of Joseph being sold into Egypt. And he knew that if Simeon had not wanted to kill him, then Reuben wouldn't have sold him Judah would not have sold Joseph to the Egyptians, to the Ishmaelites, that is, because the only reason Judah had sold Joseph was to protect him from Simeon. So then Simeon says, "And when we went down into Egypt and he bound me as a spy, I knew that I was suffering justly and I grieved not." Basically, remember in Genesis, we're told that when the brothers came down, Simeon had to stay as a surety, a guarantee that they would come back with Benjamin. He said, "You have to come back with Benjamin so you prove that you guys are not lying. So go down, get your brother Benjamin, but while you go away, Simeon has to stay with me." So that I, you know, and so Simeon stayed with him. And basically, from Simeon's perspective, he did not know that this was Joseph. And he was basically like, "I deserve this. I was a horrible person. I sinned horribly against Joseph. I sold him he was sold in slavery on my, because of me. And it's fitting that now I am in slavery too by the Egyptians, because it's my fault that this happened to Joseph. So now it's just fitting that it happened to me. It's kind of like karma, you know, that type of thing. It all comes around. What goes around comes around, that idea. So now if this had happened to Simeon when he had not repented, he would have even been more angry and more envious. Those people are not in prison. I didn't do anything wrong. My brothers, why did Joseph pick me? That's not fair. All my brothers get to go. But because he had a change of heart, he approached it differently and said, this is fitting. I deserve this. So it's just an amazing testament to how much a person can change through true heartfelt repentance. And this is clearly what happened with Simeon. Now, he says of Joseph, "Joseph was a good man, had the spirit of God within him, being compassionate and pitiful. He bore no malice against me, but loved me even as the rest of his brethren." So basically, Joseph didn't hold a grudge. He knew that Simeon was the one who wanted to kill him, and yet Joseph forgave him and treated him as a regular, the rest of the brothers. He loved him. And that's just that moved Simeon. Simeon, like, realized, wow, this is a righteous man. This is me. How, you know, and they just, it convinced him how horrible and how wrong he had been, because he wanted to kill a man like Joseph, who was so much, so humble, so righteous in his heart. So Simeon learned a lot from seeing how much of a good example Joseph was. So Simeon tells us to beware of jealousy and envy and walk in singleness of heart, that God may give you grace and glory and blessing upon your heads, even as you saw in Joseph's case. Because Joseph, he walked in singleness of heart, and because of this, he was blessed. Even in difficult situations, it all turned around for his benefit. So if you walk in singleness of heart, you will be given grace and glory and blessing, and you won't be destroyed. You won't go into destruction, but you will be, you know, the law tells us of the blessings. If you obey the law, you will be blessed. You will be given all these amazing blessings. But if you disobey the law, you'll have all these curses. So it's kind of the same thing here. That's what Simeon is telling us. Simeon goes on to say, "All his days he reproached us not," he's talking about Joseph, "he reproached us not concerning this thing, but loved us as his own soul, and beyond his own sons glorified us and gave us riches and cattle and fruits." So normally, people will love their own children more than their own brothers sometimes. But in Joseph's case, he didn't do that. He loved his brothers. He glorified them more than his own children. He just showed how important his brothers were to him and how much he loved them. So he basically says, Simeon says, follow Joseph's example. He says, "Do ye also, my children, love each one his brother with a good heart, and the spirit of envy will withdraw from you." So love your brother, and you won't be envious of him. It's very simple. And yet people complicate it so much. They don't follow what love is. If they just loved people, then they wouldn't be led into all these sins that they are so often led into. So he tells us that envy maketh savage the soul and destroyeth the body. It causes anger and war in the mind, and stirs up unto deeds of blood, and leadeth the mind into frenzy, and causeth tumult to the soul and trembling to the body, in which we know this is true because of Simeon's example. And many, probably in your life, you've known people who are really envious and they're full of anger and hate. He says, even in sleep, some malicious jealousy deluding him gnaweth, and with wicked spirits disturbeth his soul, and causeth the body to be troubled, and waketh the mind from sleep and confusion. And as a wicked and poisonous spirit, so appeareth it to men. Basically, he's telling us, someone could be so focused on jealousy and envy that it can disturb their own sleep and really mess with them. And so this is important because what we do in our life will affect our sleep and our overall health. That's what he's telling us. And you won't get a good sleep if you are envious. You will have sleep problems. So this is kind of a practical thing that he's teaching us. And it's poison. Envy is poison, he says. And he says, therefore was Joseph comely in appearance and goodly to look upon, because no wickedness dwelt in him. For some of the trouble of the spirit the face manifesteth. Stopping there for a second. Simeon's basically telling us, if you do sins, very often the sins you do are going to appear on your face. It's not like you can see someone like a mark there and say, oh, that person just committed adultery. It's not like that. Rather, it's various sins lead to a more angry appearance or a more depressed appearance, things like that. So basically, if you are doing sin, it's going to mess up your facial appearance and your overall appearance is going to look unattractive as compared to what it would have been. And but if you are righteous, your face will glow and shine. Stephen's face, what did Stephen's face look like? It looked like angels, heavenly angels, because he was pure and innocent. So Joseph was comely in appearance and goodly to look upon, because there was no wickedness in his heart, in his spirit. And Simeon says, some of the trouble of the spirit the face manifesteth. So he clarifies and says, not all the trouble appears on someone's face, but it just, there's signs of trouble, of wickedness that comes on your face. And in the Dead Sea Scrolls, we see mention of this, that, like, you know, it talks about certain parts of the face, trying to determine someone's face and how that corresponds with their righteousness. I think it's in the Dead Sea Scrolls, but sometimes some of those fragments might have been from another cave that wasn't really the Dead Sea Scrolls. But according to the scholars, this is from the Dead Sea Scrolls. So for now, we assume that it is, and this supports that idea that you can look at someone's face and see signs of wickedness. And then Simeon says, make your hearts good before the Lord and your ways straight before men, and ye shall find grace before the Lord and men. Then he tells us, beware of fornication, for fornication is the mother of all evils, separating from God and bringing near to Belial. That's exactly what Reuben said. And he says, I have seen it inscribed in the writing of Enoch that your sons shall be corrupted in fornication and shall do harm to the sons of Levi with the sword, but they shall not be able to withstand Levi. For he shall wage the war of the Lord, and shall conquer all your hosts. And they shall be few in number, divided in Levi and Judah, and there shall be none of you for sovereignty, even as also our father prophesied in his blessings. So, basically, Simeon says he read in Enoch, writing of Enoch. The problem is, what he's saying that Enoch said is not in our copies of Enoch. It's most likely the case that it's a whole other writing of Enoch that is now gone from us. Evidence to support that this is possible is the Dead Sea Scrolls were found, and there were at least there were at least two or three different books of Enoch that were found there. There was the Book of Giants, and it had books that Enoch wrote to the giants, telling them other things, prophecies. And then it also had a book that Enoch wrote to Methuselah about Lamech's son Noah, and it gave prophecies of the future of Noah's children. And so that might have been the writing that Simeon read. Or perhaps it was the Book of Enoch as we have it, but a fuller version that had the prophecy. So basically, Simeon tells us that he saw in the writing of Enoch that the children of Simeon would be corrupted in fornication, and that they would do harm to the sons of Levi with the sword. They would fight, but that they would not be able to withstand Levi. Remember, Reuben tried to fight against Levi, according to the testament of Reuben. Reuben's children, that is. The prophecy was that Reuben's children would try to fight against Levi, but they would fail. Likewise, we're told here, Simeon's children are going to fight against Levi's children, but they're going to fail as well. They will not be able to withstand Levi, Simeon says. For he, Levi that is, shall wage the war of the Lord and shall conquer all your hosts. Levi will conquer over your hosts, Simeon, the children of Simeon. And they shall be few in number, divided in Levi and Judah. And there shall be none of you for sovereignty, even as also our father prophesied in his blessings. That's in Genesis chapter 49, I think it is. Remember, Jacob gave the blessings for all his 12 sons. He said, for each of the sons, he predicted something for them. So basically, this is just a confirmation that this truly was going to be fulfilled, that Jacob's prophecy would happen. And that, remember, Simeon and Levi were joined together in that prophecy of Jacob. And they were going to be few, it said, because of their anger and warring. And this is what Simeon is telling us will indeed happen. And that, and we, from the history of the scriptures, we know that it did happen. And he says, Simeon says, "Behold, I have told you all things that I may be acquitted of your sin." This basically corresponds with Ezekiel 18, where basically Ezekiel says, you have to declare to others you are a watchman. You tell others of the danger coming, and once you tell them, you're off the hook. You're no longer held accountable. If you don't tell them, then you're accountable for their blood if they die. Similarly here, Simeon told them all things so that he would no longer be accountable for their sin. He said, "I told you all things that I may be acquitted of your sin." And he says, a prophecy of if you flee from envy, then you will be blessed. He gives a more detailed one, but I'm just going to skip that. And he speaks about the perishing of the seed of Canaan and Amalek and the Cappadocians and the Hittites. So these are all prophecies. Speaks of the land of Ham being of failing, and all different types of prophecies. Then it says, "Then shall a sign be glorified greatly unto Israel, for the Lord God, appearing on earth, shall come as man, and saving through him man. Then shall all the spirits of the sea be given to be trodden underfoot, and men shall rule over wicked spirits. Then shall I arise in joy, and will bless the Most High because of his marvelous works, because God hath taken a body and eaten with men and saved men." This is a prophecy of the Messiah, clearly. As I mentioned in the beginning, this is a shortened version of the full original version of the Testaments. Some scribes created a shorter version, which I believe is reliable, but it's not the original. So the original might have been much longer, and perhaps it wasn't as to the point. It might have been a longer prophecy, which didn't state it so succinctly like this. But I trust this prophecy, so I believe that this was truly prophesied by Simeon, but perhaps his prophecy of these events was in more detail or more words. But so, Simeon, according to this prophecy that we read, that the Messiah would come, and that he is Yahweh, Yahuwah, he is Elohim, and he would come as a man, saving through him mankind. And then it says that Simeon blessed God because because of realizing that God would take a body and eat with men and save men. So then Simeon says, "My children, obey Levi and Judah, and be not lifted up against the two tribes, for from them shall arise unto you the salvation of God. For the Lord shall raise up from Levi, as it were, a high priest, and from Judah, as it were, a king, God and man. He shall save all the Gentiles and the race of Israel. Therefore I give you these commands, that ye also may command your children, that they may observe them throughout their generations." So this is a prophecy of the Messiah once again, and it said that he's going to come from the tribe of Levi and the tribe of Judah. The tribe of Levi would be the high priest role, and then the tribe of Judah would be the royal role, the king role. So the Messiah would be a king and a priest, a high priest. Some people interpreted there being two messiahs. One was going to be from Judah and one was going to be from Levi. But according to Simeon, it's one messiah, one person, and two roles. The Lord shall raise up from Levi a high priest and from Judah a king. And he, so it doesn't say they, he shall save all the Gentiles and the race of Israel. So this is a prophecy of not only Israel, but even the Gentiles too will be covered by the high priesthood of this man that's going to be raised up, and this king that will be. So amazing prophecies from what we are seeing in these books. It says, after Simeon died, they laid him in a wooden coffin to take up his bones to Hebron. They took them up secretly during a war of the Egyptians, for the bones of Joseph the Egyptians guarded in the tombs of the kings. The sorcerers told them that on the departure of the bones of Joseph, there should be throughout all the land darkness and gloom, and an exceeding great plague to the Egyptians, so that even with a lamp, a man should not recognize his brother. So basically, this tells us that the sorcerers had told them that once Joseph's bones are gone, there's going to be a plague of darkness throughout all the land. And this is what happened in Exodus. We're told that when Joseph's bones were about to be departed, there was a plague of darkness. So this is a fulfillment of the prophecy that the Testament of Simeon tells us about. And the war, it says they took the bones up secretly during a war of the Egyptians. And this explains, this corresponds with the Testament of Amram. There was a war of the Egyptians, and they took up the bones during this war secretly. And the Book of Jubilees says this as well. Now I'm going to stop here for a second. We're approaching about 2 hours, so here's what we can do. I will either end it here now, or if you guys want me to do one more testament, I can try to do another testament. So from you all who are here right now, what would you like me to do? Because, as I said, we've already been 2 hours, but if you want more, I can do one more testament. But otherwise, we'll have to continue next week. I'm going to be continuing next week regardless, because there's 12 testaments, and I've only done two so far, so I have to do the whole thing. Okay. Okay, I'm going to skip the testament of Levi and Judah, because those are longer ones, okay? I'm going to skip those this time. Next time I'll do Levi and Judah, and perhaps others. So, Levi's a really good one, but we don't have enough time for that. That's going to take a while. So, we'll do Levi's next week, and then Judah's also one of the longest ones. So, we'll do Judah's next week. Now, Lauren, you came here after we had been here for a little while. We had gone through the Testament of Reuben, so you can listen to that on the recording if you want, my overview of Reuben's Testament. So I'm going to do, let's see here. Yeah, there's so much to learn. And this is only one book, the Testaments. There's so many other books, and there's some great stuff in these books. So, I will do the Testament of Issachar. This is not a long one, so this shouldn't take too long. So he says, the copy of the words of Issachar. For he called his sons and said to them, hearken, my children, to Issachar your father. He says, I was born the fifth son to Jacob by way of hire for the mandrakes. Remember, that's what Genesis tells us about. That story of Leah and Rachel did the exchange of the mandrakes. Rachel received the mandrakes from Leah, and Leah bought the right to sleep with Jacob, because she didn't have that right at that time. She got permission from Rachel by paying her the mandrakes. So this son, Issachar, was born because of that exchange, that payment that was made. So it's kind of a negative thing that's always surrounding, like, you know, in Hebrew culture, the names reflected their origin of birth usually. And in Hosea, two of Hosea's sons were pretty bad names. One of them was Not Loved, and the other was Not My People. So what do you think? One of the children would be like, every time their name is Not Loved, it makes people think that their parent, the father, did not love the child. It's really a negative name, and Not My People, it's a similar negativity. Issachar, his name meant basically man of hire, man of the payment. It reminded him of this little exchange. So whenever someone said Issachar, it told him, you came from prostitution, you son of a prostitute. You know, basically that's what it meant. So, and when I say prostitute, I mean that in a less offensive sense. Basically, Leah paid Rachel in order that she could sleep with Jacob. So it's a kind of a form of prostitution, in a sense. But it's not straight up prostitution, as you know, as the sinful people do it. So this is the very man that was born from this event, Issachar. And he's telling us in his own words about this incident. He says, Reuben, my brother, brought in mandrakes from the field, and Rachel met him and took them. And Reuben wept, and at his voice, Leah, my mother, came forth. So Reuben's weeping. Leah comes and says, what's wrong? And because basically Rachel stole them from Reuben. So, and Reuben was kind of a young man, so he was hurt by that. And so Leah came to comfort him and find out what was wrong. And so Issachar says, now these were sweet-smelling apples. It's possible that's a false translation, but that's what it says. It says, apples, which were produced in the land of Haran, below a ravine of water. And Rachel said, I will not give them to thee, but they shall be to me instead of children. For the Lord hath despised me, and I have not borne children to Jacob. Basically, Rachel was really upset that she did not have children. And she, kind of a similar thing with what I was saying about Simeon, how he wanted things for himself. And Rachel was saying, I deserve to have at least something good. It's not fair. I don't have any children. You get all the children, and I don't. Let me at least have these mandrakes. Don't take everything for yourself. Please give me something to appreciate and to value. And so Issachar says, now there were two apples. And Leah said to Rachel, let it suffice thee that thou hast taken my husband. Will thou take these also? So Leah is kind of taking a spin on it, because in Leah's perspective, she married Jacob first, which is true. That's what Genesis says. Of course, as we remember, Leah deceived Jacob into it. So that was kind of not nice on her part. But so Leah takes it that different way and says, He was mine, and you took him from me. And now you want to take the mandrakes that belong to me too? Because Reuben had taken it first, so it really belonged to, Leah first, but then Rachel took the mandrakes from Reuben. So it's just kind of like, take Reuben there and then substitute Jacob. And that's kind of what, it's like a symbolic of that struggle where, Leah was supposed to by right have Jacob, but then Rachel stole the mandrakes or stole Jacob, from Leah. So that's what's going on here. That's a symbolic thing of a struggle between them, between Rachel and Leah right now. And so Rachel says, and Rachel said to her, thou shalt have Jacob this night for the mandrakes of thy son. So she's basically saying, okay, you can have Jacob if you give me the mandrakes, because I'm not getting any children from Jacob, so you can have Jacob, and I'll have the mandrakes. At least I'll have something that can benefit me. At least I can have something where I will be pleasant in the sight of God. Because, as she said, God despised me because I don't have any children. So she thought maybe if she can have these mandrakes, then maybe God won't despise her as much. You'll see that later on. That's her reasoning. Basically in Genesis, we're not told the reason why Rachel wanted these mandrakes so much. But we're told later on in the Testament here why. And that is because she wanted to try to become favored with God. And it ended up working, which I will share in a second. So Leah said to her, Issachar continues saying, and Leah said to her, Jacob is mine, for I am the wife of his youth. Leah is correct on this. That is absolutely true. However, Jacob and Rachel didn't think it like that. They thought because it was deception that it wasn't a valid marriage and that Rachel was the true wife. But that's not how God viewed it, because God, he punished Rachel with barrenness, and Leah he blessed with. God clearly chose the side, because Leah was unloved when she should have been loved, and the love was given to Rachel when it did not belong to her. And so, as I said, Leah said to her, Jacob is mine, for I am the wife of his youth. But Rachel said, boast not. In other manuscripts it says, how so? So boast not and vaunt not thyself. For he espoused me before thee, and for my sake he served our father 14 years. And had not craft increased on the earth, and the wickedness of men prospered, thou wouldest not now see the face of Jacob. For thou art not his wife, but in craft wert taken to him in my stead. And my father deceived me, and removed me on that night, and did not suffer Jacob to see me. For had I been there, this had not happened to him. Nevertheless, for the mandrakes, I am hiring Jacob to thee for one night. So basically, we have Rachel disputing what Leah is saying. Leah is saying, I'm his wife of his youth. And Rachel said, no, you're not his wife of his youth, because you tricked him into it, in deceit. So you're not his wife. That's her words exactly. For thou art not his wife, but in craft wert taken to him in my stead. So in Rachel's mind, it's deception. That can't be a legitimate marriage. So she justified this from her understanding. It was limited understanding, though. In God's eyes, just because it was deception does not mean that it was not a valid marriage. And in the Book of Jubilees, we actually learn something that we don't know about in Genesis. And that is, Jubilees tells us Laban was in the right for what he did, actually. It doesn't exactly say he was in the right. What it says is his custom is correct. It is lawful. That is the law. Basically, the law of Jubilees, it tells us, a man is not allowed to give his younger daughter in marriage before the older daughter. Because this is an abomination. This is a very wicked thing to do. Those are the very words of Jubilees. And so, hold on, let me So you know that I'm not making it up. I will read that in a second as I load the page. It's loading. But yeah, so... And this also explains why in Genesis we see that Leah asks Rachel. She needs to get permission from Rachel in order to sleep with Jacob. It doesn't make sense, because if Leah was the full wife of... If Leah was considered by Jacob the full wife, then she wouldn't need to go to Rachel. She could just approach Jacob and say, I want to sleep with you. Let's do it. And then Jacob would have done it. But she went to Rachel instead. That's really bizarre. That's... Who would do that? Unless Rachel had an authority. And Leah wasn't truly considered a wife by either of them. She was treated as a mere concubine. Because she was unloved. And that's why Leah was given the blessing over Rachel of having children. And Rachel couldn't have children because they were treating Leah unfairly. So I found it. And it says, see here, it says in Jubilees the following. And Laban said to Jacob, it is not so done in our country to give the younger before the elder. And it is, that's what Laban said. And then Jubilees continues and says, and it is not right to do this. For thus it is ordained and written in the heavenly tablets that no one should give his younger daughter before the elder. But the elder one gives first, and after her the younger. And the man who does so, they set down guilt against him in heaven. And none is righteous that does this thing. For this deed is evil before the Lord. And command thou the children of Israel that they do not this thing. Let them neither take nor give the younger before they have given the elder. For it is very wicked. Now, as I've said in other teachings, some people will say, that's not mentioned in the law of Moses, so that's not valid. Jubilees is false because it's adding stuff. As I've explained before, the Dead Sea Scrolls copies of the law are much longer, have extra laws. So the case is that the Dead Sea Scrolls must have originally had this law, because as we found in the Temple Scroll has extra laws for marriage. So it would make sense that this law right here would have been in the Temple Scroll in one of the missing sections, because as I said, the Temple Scroll, many parts of it are missing at the top of the page, and the beginning and end of the scroll is missing, so there must have been a lot more of the Temple Scroll, and this law must have been in there. So we can't reject Jubilees just because this law is not in our copies, because our copies are not the original law of Moses. The original law of Moses has been shortened and laws have been removed. So this explains, basically, imagine you're Laban right now. Imagine you're Laban, and Jacob comes up and says, I want to marry your younger daughter. As the law says, according to the law, that's a wicked, very wicked thing. It'd be like someone coming up and saying, I want to rape your daughter. It's not as extreme, but basically, it's an offense. Laban was really offended by what Jacob just requested. Let me marry your daughter Rachel, please. He was like, what are you saying? He didn't want to show his frustration with what Jacob had just said, but he kept it in his heart of how offended he was that Jacob would even say something so wicked like that. And so he tricked Jacob, because he thought to himself, Rachel really loves Jacob, and she's probably not going to say no. She's probably going to go with him. And if, you know, I really want my daughters to be married. So he basically said, okay, I'll let you be with Rachel if you do the 7 years. And then at the end, he placed Leah there, because it was kind of his way of getting back at him for daring to ask him for the younger daughter in marriage first. So it was kind of like, you just slapped me in the face, Jacob. Well, I'm going to slap you in the face 7 years from now. The joke's on you, man. So that's kind of what Laban's thought process was. and it was a true marriage, even though it was deception, because when Jacob chose to sleep with that woman, and when he made his vows, he was making vows with that woman. He said, I devote myself to this woman before me. And so Jacob messed up, and he got the best of him. Laban got the best of him, but then after, Jacob did the wrong thing. He justified in his mind, saying, well, it was deception, so, you know, I should still marry Rachel, and she should be my real wife. And Laban, he knew the truth. Laban knew the truth that it was Leah, which was the true wife. And so he, in Jubilees, we're told that Laban made Jacob promise that he would not marry any other woman other than his two daughters. And then he sent them away. And so basically we have an amazing story here of how people try to justify their own actions through their own reasoning abilities, but they're very often wrong. And God's position on this is that Leah was the true wife. Even though it seems unfair because of deception, in reality, what Jacob had asked was unfair and a wicked thing. Although I believe Jacob wasn't wicked, because I believe he was ignorant in an innocent way of the law. He didn't know any better. It'd be like a child doing that. Well, a child is not evil for doing that because he doesn't realize how bad it is. In a similar way, I don't believe Jacob fully knew what he was asking, and so I don't think he was held accountable as a wicked person for it, but it was still a wicked thing that he had asked, and so he was learning by example and by painful experience how making assumptions is not a good thing and can lead to bad consequences. But so there was this struggle of who's the real wife? Is it Rachel or Leah? Jacob kind of went back and forth between the two, but he gave Rachel the precedence, and he would only sleep with Leah as a concubine, and a concubine was sort of like a replacement wife for the service of giving birth, having children for the woman that could not have children. So Rachel couldn't have children, so she sometimes let him sleep with Leah, and sometimes let him sleep with the other concubines for the purpose of childbearing. And so Jacob and Rachel had it opposite. But that's the debate right here in the Testament of Issachar. And so Rachel says, no, I'm the real wife, but even though that's true, I'll let you sleep with him again. But the only way I'm going to let you do that is if you let me have these mandrakes, because I want something good in my life, please. So they agree to that exchange. And Issachar says, and Jacob knew Leah, and she conceived and bare me, and on account of the hire, I was called Issachar. He then continues and says, then appeared to Jacob an angel of the Lord, saying, two children shall Rachel bear, inasmuch as she hath refused company with her husband, and hath chosen continency. And had not Leah, my mother, paid the two apples for the sake of his company, she would have borne eight sons. For this reason, she bare six, and Rachel bare the two. For on account of the mandrakes, the Lord visited her. For he knew that for the sake of children, she wished to company with Jacob, and not for lust of pleasure. For on the morrow, also, she again gave up Jacob. Because of the mandrakes, therefore, the Lord hearkened to Rachel. For though she desired them, she ate them not, but offered them in the house of the Lord, presenting them to the priests of the Most High, who was at that time. So basically, Leah was in the wrong here. I don't think Leah was guilty of sin in this instance, but she did the wrong thing. Basically, God had blessed Leah, and he was going to give her eight children. However, Leah was Leah She, how do I put this? Basically, she shouldn't have given up the two apples, the mandrakes. She shouldn't have gone through with that. She should have insisted and said, those are mine, and I refuse to give those over, and Jacob is mine, and so no. But instead, she kind of gave in and said, okay, fine. Jacob's yours, fine, but I'll give you the mandrakes in exchange that I can sleep with your husband. Okay? Deal? So when she made that deal, God says, okay, Leah just indicated that she's agreeing with the idea that Rachel is the true wife. And so she is denying the truth. She's going against it. And so because of this, Leah was punished by not having the two children she otherwise would have. And Rachel, remember as I said, Rachel wanted those mandrakes because she wanted to win favor with God. Because she knew, if I could just have those mandrakes, then I can win favor from God and he'll know that, like, I'll win my right to have children, maybe, perhaps. Or even if not, I will... hold on. The image is frozen. Can you guys still see me? Hold on. Okay. For some reason, the it froze and then it quit me out. Sorry about that. I'm almost finished here. So basically, Rachel knew that if she could just have those mandrakes, then perhaps she could get in favor with God, and that God wouldn't be so against her anymore. Perhaps if she offered it as a sacrifice, maybe he would see that sacrifice and her goodwill and intention, and then he would bless her somehow. If she had done any sin or was angry with him, then perhaps that would be a way to appease his anger at her. And so that's what she did, and it worked. It's exactly what happened. She took the mandrakes, even though she wanted to eat those mandrakes, they were really delicious, just like Adam and Eve, you know, they were really lusting after they eat the food, and they gave into it. But Rachel, she said, I'm not going to eat these. If she had eaten those, then she would not have gotten the children. But she humbly offered those mandrakes to God and said, here, these mandrakes belong to you. And please have mercy on me and have favor on me. And God saw that. He saw what Leah had done, that Leah had denied her right, and that Rachel had denied her right to the mandrakes. And because of this, he decided to give Rachel in grace and mercy the two children for the two mandrakes. If it had been only one mandrake, he would have only given Rachel one, but it was two, and that's why Issachar tells us that that's why she was given two children. It's an amazing teaching that we don't find out in Genesis, but I accept testaments of scripture, testaments of the 12 patriarchs, so this teaching I trust very much. So then Issachar says, when therefore, oh wait, one more thing, the priest of the Most High God, the Most High, who was at that time, that's what Issachar says, that was, I think, Isaac. I think it was Isaac. Who was the priest at that time, but it was possibly Levi. Isaac, I'm pretty certain. And so, in the house of the Lord was just a tabernacle, or the area, the holy place. And so he says, when therefore I grew up, my children, I walked in uprightness of heart, And I became a husbandman for my father and my brethren, and I brought in fruits from the field according to their season. And my father blessed me, for he saw that I walked in rectitude before him, and I was not a busybody in my doings, nor envious and malicious against my neighbor. I never slandered anyone, nor did I censure the life of any man, walking as I did in singleness of eye. Therefore, when I was 35 years old, I took to myself a wife, for my labor wore away my strength, and I never thought upon pleasure with woman. But owing to my toil, sleep overcame me. And my father always rejoiced in my rectitude, because I offered through the priests to the Lord all first fruits, then to my father also. And the Lord increased 10,000-fold his benefits in my hands. And also Jacob my father knew that God aided my singleness. For on all the poor and oppressed I bestowed the good things of the earth in the singleness of my heart. So I'll stop here for a second. So we see Issachar was a man of labor. He worked hard the land. And just like Reuben advised, in the Testament of Reuben, Reuben advised us to focus on good works of labor and study and the flocks. Don't focus on having a woman. That's exactly what Issachar did. He didn't think of women. He just focused on the farming and taking care of animals. And he gave the fruits to the priests, to God, as a dedicated offering. And he was not a busybody. He wasn't envious like Simeon. He wasn't malicious like Simeon. And he never slandered anyone. And he said that he gave to the poor, and the oppressed, which is the thing that the prophets always emphasize. Help the poor. You need to help the poor. It's a very important teaching that the scriptures teach us. And Issachar, that was something that he was all about, because his labor was so much blessed that he was able to help so many people who were poor. Probably Gentiles who weren't true believers, but he still helped them and took care of the poor people and oppressed people. And so we see a true example of righteousness and piety in Issachar. And Issachar was so focused on his work that he would be so exhausted by the end of the day, he would just fall right asleep. This was a man of dedication. And then Issachar says, "The single man coveteth not gold." He's talking about single-minded. "He overreacheth not his neighbor. He longeth not after manifold dainties. He delighteth not in varied apparel. He doth not desire to live a long life, but only waiteth for the will of God. And the spirits of deceit have no power against him, for he looketh not on the beauty of woman, lest he should pollute his mind with corruption. There is no envy in his thoughts, nor malicious person maketh his soul to pine away, nor worry with insatiable desire in his mind. For he walketh in singleness of soul, and beholdeth all things in uprightness of heart, shunning eyes evil through the error of the world, lest he should see the perversion of any of the commandments of the Lord." So Issachar is a very righteous man. He's a great example of piety. And some of the brothers were guilty of sins, and in their testaments they tell us, "Don't do these sins like I did." But Issachar says, "Be righteous like I was." So Issachar was a very righteous man throughout his life. There was no really any major sin, or there was not much sin issue in his life. He was very a good man. He says, "Keep therefore, my children, the law of God, and get singleness, and walk in guilelessness, not playing the busybody with the business of your neighbor. But love the Lord and your neighbor, have compassion on the poor and weak, bow down your back unto husbandry, and toil in labors, in all manner of husbandry, offering gifts to the Lord of thanksgiving. For with the first fruits of the earth will the Lord bless you, even as he blessed all the saints from Abel, even until now." So we know that Issachar was familiar with Abel's story. That's important to understand. He says, "For no other portion is given to you than of the fatness of the earth, whose fruits are raised by toil. For our father Jacob blessed me with blessings of the earth and of first fruits." Remember in the blessings of Jacob, chapter 49 of Genesis, one of the blessings for Issachar was exactly what Issachar just says here. It was the fatness of the earth that would be given to him through his toil and his husbandry. And the blessings of the earth and the first fruits, it is. That's what Jacob blessed him with. Issachar then says, Levi and Judah were glorified by the Lord, even among the sons of Jacob. For the Lord gave them an inheritance, and to Levi he gave the priesthood, and to Judah the kingdom. And do ye therefore obey them, and walk in the singleness of your father. For unto Gad hath it been given to destroy the troops that are coming upon Israel. I'm not sure why he mentions Gad in this context. But so he says, obey Levi and Judah, submit to them, and basically, you know, follow your station, and because each of the sons have their role. Gad's role is to destroy the troops that are coming upon Israel. And Issachar gives a prophecy and says, in the last times, your sons will forsake singleness and will cleave unto insatiable desire, and leaving guilelessness will draw near to malice, and forsaking the commandments of the Lord, they will cleave unto Belial. And leaving husbandry, they will follow after their own devices, and they shall be dispersed among the Gentiles, and shall serve their enemies. And do ye therefore give these commands to your children, that if they sin, they may the more quickly return to the Lord. For he is merciful and will deliver them, even to bring them back into their land. That's an amazing prophecy. He knew ahead of time that there would be apostasy amongst the sons of Issachar, the tribe of Issachar, but that they could return. And basically he's telling us, you should be doing husbandry, taking care of animals. Because if you don't take care of animals, if you stop doing that, then you're going to be led astray into vain pursuits, wicked devices. So he... Issachar actually attributes abandoning husbandry as a sin, essentially, or as something that leads into sin. So he warns us and says, take care of animals. Be a husbandman, a farmer. That's an advice he gives to us. And Issachar, we're right near the end of the Testament. There's like only one tiny thing left here. He says, behold, therefore, as ye see, I am 126 years old, and I'm not conscious of committing any sin. Except my wife, I have not known any woman. I never committed fornication by the uplifting of my eyes. I drank not wine to be led astray thereby. I coveted not any desirable thing that was my neighbor's. Guile arose not in my heart. A lie passed not through my lips. If any man were in distress, I joined my sighs with his, and I shared my bread with the poor. I wrought godliness all my days. I kept truth. I love the Lord, likewise also every man with all my heart. So do ye all these things, my children, and every spirit of Belial shall flee from you, and no deed of wicked men shall rule over you, and every wild beast shall ye subdue, since ye have with you the God of heaven and earth. Walk with men in singleness of heart. So that's his advice for us right there, and he basically tells us, in his perspective, he doesn't think he's ever sinned in his entire life. However, there is a manuscript difference. Some of the manuscripts actually say, I am not conscious of committing any sin unto death. So it's possible that's the correct reading. And so he's not saying he never committed a sin, but never committed a sin unto death. So it's one of those two. He says, I'm not conscious of committing any sin, or sin unto death. And but he goes and basically justifies himself, saying, you know, he was a righteous, very righteous man throughout his whole life. He never lusted it or slept with any other woman. He wasn't a drunkard. He didn't covet anything. No guile. No lies. He says he loved every man with all his heart. That's a very bold thing to say. Most people will not say that. They'll say, well, yeah, I didn't love them with all my heart. But he says, I loved every man with all my heart. And I love the Lord too. So Issachar was confident of his own righteousness, and many people would think, that's pride, that's, you know, arrogance, how could he say something like that? But in reality, he's not being prideful or arrogant in a wicked manner like this. It says in the New Testament, do not boast except in righteousness. And he's boasting in his righteousness, but in faith. You know, he had a faith, and so he's saying, he did not do these sins. He's not saying, oh, look at me, I'm so amazing. He's saying, I obeyed God and I was faithful to him. This is a good thing. And you guys should do this too. Try to follow my example. He wasn't trying to put it in people's face and be snobbish about it. But he's saying, I led a very good life, a very righteous life, and I want you, my children, to follow my example, please. So he was being humble. He wasn't being arrogant or, you know, sinfully prideful. He was just trying to be a righteous man and teach his children how to live a good life. So we should follow Issachar's example, and we should be like him. We should not, from the time of our repentance, we should be not conscious of committing any sin. If we haven't reached that point yet, we still have work to do. We still have to change our hearts, purify our hearts, so that we get to a point where we are no longer conscious of committing any more sins after our conversion. So let's, hopefully, we will all strive to that perfection that Issachar seems to have achieved in his life. Let us all try to approach that. So that's the end of the Testament of Issachar, and that's going to be the end of my teaching for tonight. And hopefully in the future, next week's teaching, I'll be able to go through more of these testaments in a quicker fashion. Hopefully that will be the case. We will see, though. Thank you all for joining. Any final thoughts? If not, then I will see you guys next week, hopefully. And I'm gonna stop the recording now. But if there's any other questions, you can ask them, and I will answer them. Okay? If not here, on Facebook. Shalom.